Have you ever noticed how buying one thing kind of makes you buy another? You know, you get a new phone and suddenly you need a case for it. Or you buy a game console and then, well, you need games, right? It turns out that's not just a coincidence. It's actually a basic rule of economics. So let's dive in and unpack this powerful connection between the products we use every single day.
So there's this great principle, and it comes from the lectures of an economist named Michael Revive. He says, in economics, no product is an island. Now that might sound a little academic, but it points to a really simple truth. Seriously, think about the last time you went shopping. Did you buy anything that really only works when you pair it with something else? We're talking about products that are basically a team, and when they work together, well, economists have a special name for it.
And that name is complementary goods. The idea is super straightforward. These are just items that you use together. You know, like peanut butter and jelly, cars and gas, a toothbrush and toothpaste. The really important thing to get here is how their demand is linked. If way more people start buying one, you can bet they're going to start buying more of its partner too. This is the total opposite of what we call substitute goods. Think coffee versus tea, where buying more of one usually means you buy less of the other.
Okay, to really nail this down, let's look at the classic example from our source material, printers and ink. Let's call the printers product X and the ink product Y. This is the perfect example of a famous business strategy. You've probably heard of it, the razor and blades model. The idea is you sell the main thing, the printer, for a pretty low price, but then you make your real profit on the stuff people have to keep buying over and over, in this case, the ink. It's a perfect look at how this economic idea is used to shape whole markets.
All right, so let's set the scene here. What you're looking at is the demand curve for ink. We'll just call it D. This is our starting point, our before picture. It basically shows us, under normal conditions, how much ink people are willing to buy at different prices. And see how it slopes down? That's just because, usually, while the price of something drops, people want to buy more of it. Simple enough, right?
But now, let's throw a wrench in the works. Imagine some big economic event happens. Maybe a cool new paperless technology comes out. Or maybe the price of printers just goes through the roof. For whatever reason, people just start buying fewer printers. So the big question is, what do you think happens to the market for ink?
And here's our answer. The entire demand curve for ink shifts to the left from our original D to this new one, D1. Now, this is the absolute key. A shift in the whole curve means there's less demand at every single price. It's not just that people are buying less ink because it got more expensive. No, they're buying less ink, period, because fewer people have the printers that need it in the first place.
You know, the source material for this whole explainer actually sums it up with this really simple, elegant Hebrew phrase, ekamut holechet imekamot, and that just translates to, the quantity goes with the quantity. It's perfect, right? If the quantity of the main product, the printer, goes down, then the quantity demanded of its partner, the ink, is going to follow it right down too.
So let's just walk through that logic one more time, step by step, because it's so important. First, the number of printers being sold goes down. Step two, because of that, fewer people out there actually need ink. Step three, that causes the total overall demand for ink to fall. And step four, that's what we see on the graph, the whole demand curve makes a move to the left. It's a really clear cause and effect story.
Okay, so why should you care? Why is this more than just some theory in a textbook? Well, it has huge real-world effects. For businesses, understanding this is absolutely crucial for predicting sales. I mean, if you sell hot dog buns, you better be keeping an eye on hot dog sales, right? It also explains all those ripple effects you see in the economy. And for you and me, it just makes us smarter consumers. It helps us see how a price change in one area might affect the cost of something totally different that we also need.
When you get right down to it, this whole idea just shows how connected everything is in our economy. So I'll leave you with this question. Just look around you right now. Think about your day so far, your coffee and the sugar you put in it, your laptop and its charger, your shoes and your socks. What complementary goods have you already used today? I promise, once you start looking for them, you'll see these pairs everywhere.